So good afternoon. You're all very welcome here this evening. My name is Siobhan Mullally, Director of the Irish Centre for Human Rights, and we're delighted to co-host this event this evening with the International Law Association Irish Branch. And I'm delighted to welcome our distinguished speaker, Professor Fionnuala Nialón, UN Special Rapporteur on Human Rights and Counterterrorism, and a Galway native. And very honoured to welcome our chair for this evening, Honourable Justice Ms. Isalta O'Malley of the Supreme Court of Ireland. I'll just briefly introduce Judge O'Malley and then hand it over to her to chair the event, and we will have concluding remarks from James Kingston, Legal Advisor, Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade. Judge O'Malley is a judge of the Supreme Court of Ireland since 2015 and previously served on the High Court from 2012 to 2015. She is a graduate of Trinity College Dublin and also of King's Inns. She was called to the bar in 1987 and became a senior counsel in 2007 and has a very distinguished record of practice, particularly in the field, specializing in the field of criminal justice. But also has a long track record and history of advocacy for access to justice. And she served as a chairperson and on the National Council of the Free Legal Advice Centres for more than two decades, and was recognised for her services to FLAC and for access to justice in Ireland through an award as Person of the Year in 2004. Delighted now to hand over to Judge Isalta O'Malley. Thank you.
Siobhan, thank you very much for that very kind introduction. It's a great privilege to be here this evening and to be asked to chair this most important lecture, the annual distinguished lecture, which this evening will be given by a particularly distinguished lecturer, who is, of course, a native of this city, and that's Professor Fionnuala Nialón. I'm very pleased and happy also to welcome Professor Nialón's parents, Pádraig and Betty, who are with us this evening, and we're delighted that you could attend with us. Professor Nialón was appointed to the position of UN Special Rapporteur on the promotion and protection of human rights and fundamental freedoms while countering terrorism in August of 2017. That not being a sufficient outlet for her energies, she holds down positions on both sides of the Atlantic. She's a University Regents Professor at the University of Minnesota, holder of the Rabina Chair in Law, Public Policy and Society. She's also a faculty director of the Human Rights Center in the University of Minnesota Law School. Meanwhile, she's a professor of law at Queen's University Belfast and was previously co-director and professor of law at the Transitional Justice Institute in Belfast. She has a number of publications to her name, including Law in Times of Crisis, On the Frontlines, Gender War and the Post-Conflict Process, Exceptional Courts and Military Commissions in Comparative and Policy Perspectives, and the Oxford Handbook on Gender and Conflict. Previously, she's been a representative of the prosecutor in the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia, dealing with war crimes trials in Bosnia. In 2003, she was appointed by the Secretary General of the United Nations as a special expert on promoting gender equality in times of conflict and peacemaking. In 2011, she was appointed as consultant jointly by the Office of the High Commissioner on Human Rights and UN Women to prepare a study on reparations for conflict-related sexual violence. In 2015, she was appointed by the International Criminal Court's Trust Fund for Victims to lead an expert review on reparations to victims in the court's first case. Meanwhile, on this side of the Atlantic, she was appointed by the Minister for Justice to the Irish Human Rights Commission in 2000, and she served in that position for 5 years. She's an elected member of the Executive Committee for the Belfast-based Committee on the Administration of Justice, and she's a member of the Irish Council for Civil Liberties. I think that that is probably enough to be going on with. What we hoped to hear from Fionnuala this evening relates mainly to gender-related concepts in the in the arena of counter-terrorism. And for those of you who have a tendency to mix up your special Security Council resolutions and who are unfamiliar with certain concepts in this area, we hope that Fionnuala is going to give us a great deal of concrete information and explanation and insights into the very difficult of area of work that she's engaged in. Thank you. Thank you.
Gurnil Magid, ta shaga halin yven shaing alia harit mar chortior, ni hagam gminik mar chortior mar bimatiach ta walia gminik. Tá me anmhuíocht an chuire a fuairme le leabhairt an seánacht, má bhuíochas don ollscoil, don Justice O'Reilly, don Talamh, Siobhán Mullally, agus na cairde uilig atá bailí chun leabhairt lom an seo tráthnóna agus tá an-áthas orm sibh uilig ceall. So first of all, to say it's really strange to be a guest in your own hometown, but lovely, so I recommend it highly. It's also a really rare privilege to come back and be asked to speak in your hometown and to be able to talk about the work you do in that context. I'm really grateful to the university for offering me the opportunity to give this distinguished lecture, to Justice O'Malley for introducing me so nicely, for Professor Siobhán Mullally, who also made it happen, brought me here, and many friends and colleagues at the Human Rights Centre who have supported my work and me personally over the years. So it's a real pleasure to be here. So I have the I'd call it the rare privilege of being a scholar who gets to practice her theory in the real world every day. And that is really a unique and quite extraordinary privilege too. And what that has allowed me to do is to bring decades of scholarly work on conflict, on gender, on violence, and on terrorism into my everyday practice as UN Special Rapporteur. And so my comments tonight are going to reflect on a range of both scholarly and conceptual issues, and I think those are important to think of in that way, but also is interlaced with the daily work that involves states, non-state actors, international institutions, and increasingly private entities who are populating the counter-terrorism space. So when I took up the role of Special Rapporteur, it was fairly obvious to me at least, and not least because I was the first woman to hold this role, and as many of you might instinctively recognize, the field of counterterrorism and security has largely been dominated by male actors. There are very few women in that space, but it was obvious to me that I was going to make gender mainstreaming a priority for my mandate. And I've tried to follow through on that commitment in my work. And maybe just to say briefly what the three primary things a Special Rapporteur does to frame what that is. A Special Rapporteur has a number of, I would call them, capacities. They're not really powers because they have limited formal capacity of implementation, but I have three capacities. I conduct country visits at the invitation of a state. And generally one woos a state to invite you, and that's its own process of courtship and practice of encouraging states to see the benefit of having a Special Rapporteur come and allow that state to expose itself to international scrutiny. So we do country visits, and I have conducted two visits so far, France and Belgium last year, but completed five reports because my predecessors conducted visits but hadn't yet completed the reports. So I presented five reports to the Human Rights Council this year, France, Belgium, Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, Tunisia, and Sri Lanka, some of those being particularly complicated countries, as you might guess. So that's the first capacity, the capacity to undertake country visits. The second is thematic reports. Each Special Rapporteur gets to choose the issues that they think are particularly important to bring to the attention of states, and you have two opportunities a year, one before the General Assembly each autumn, the second in the spring before the Human Rights Council, to bring issues that you think are particularly important to the attention of states, to make recommendations, and to encourage maybe different state practice. My thematic reports to date have focused on three issues that I think are particularly important. One is the governance of global counterterrorism, something I'm going to talk a little bit about today in my remarks on gender, how the law, the global counterterrorism law gets made, and the architecture of the global counterterrorism system. The second issue I've had a long-standing preoccupation with is states of emergency, the use of exceptional powers by states, and in particular their use in the counterterrorism domain. And the third, which is the report I presented to the Human Rights Council this spring, which is on the misuse of counterterrorism. And in the spring, just a couple of weeks ago, I was in Geneva presenting my report on the misuse of counterterrorism legislation and practice against civil society actors, which is a global and pernicious phenomena that I'm particularly concerned about. So that's the second capacity to issue these reports, to encourage governments to pay attention to particularly pressing issues. The third is the role of communications. My office, like every special rapporteur's office, gets to receive individual communications from either particular persons or groups who feel they have been unfairly or disproportionately or illegally targeted by counterterrorism, preventing violent extremism or state security measures. And as you can imagine, there's a lot of communications and little capacity, something I'll also talk about later. And I make choices about the cases we will intervene in. In the best case scenario, I will engage directly with the government and hope that that intervention might bring a particular resolution to a particular individual. And sometimes governments listen and sometimes they don't. So those are the three capacities. And in each one of those areas, I have sought to infuse a gendered approach, a particular attention to gender issues in the way that I do that. Now, when I announced at the General Assembly in my very first, about 6 weeks after my appointment, when I said this was going to be one of the priorities for the mandate, I actually assumed I was going to get a kind of a kickback or some antagonism to that. Because some of you may recall, those who follow the counterterrorism space, my predecessor, Martin Scheinen, who was the first UN Special Rapporteur, had issued a thematic report in 2009 addressing the issue of gender and counterterrorism. And Professor Scheinen, in fact, at the time, received a pretty extraordinary kickback from states. There was a general sense of hostility to the enterprise of engaging issues of gender. And the response was to say that both gender itself, the idea of addressing masculinities or women's rights in the counterterrorism space, was really ultra vires the scope of the mandate's powers, and that it had a sort of a hegemonic quality to it, that it was not a good thing for a special rapporteur to be talking about human rights and gender in counterterrorism, because that was imposing a certain view of women's rights into spheres where they were not wanted or needed. So in 2017, I assumed that I might have some of the same response by states. But what was kind of interesting, and we'll explore this a little bit in the lecture, was that it was quite the opposite. There has been, for quite a while, quite significant, I want to call it gender conversation, taking place in the security sphere at the UN. And this has primarily been brought about by something called the Women, Peace and Security Agenda, occasioned by a UN Security Council resolution, Resolution 1325, that mandated for the first time, this is in 2000, that women ought to be included in the peace and security domain. So from now for almost 20 years, we're nearly at 20 years of the Women, Peace and Security Agenda, it's become sort of the norm to talk about women and security. But I want to suggest that that's not quite as progressive as it may seem on its face. So when I decided to do this work, it was clear to me that there was less resistance than there used to be, that there was a greater language that one could tap into to talk about women's rights in particular in the context of security, and that in the global counterterrorism architecture, and by that I mean the Security Council and its subsidiary organ, the Counterterrorism Committee, which is primarily charged with responsibility of overseeing the counterterrorism space post 9/11, that it was easier to do gender. Gender is now referred to in multiple Security Council resolutions that regulate terrorism. So just last week, we had March 28th, so it's a little over a week, we had a new Security Council resolution on terrorist financing. And in that Security Council resolution, we find a reference to gender, to making sure that regulation in this area doesn't unduly encroach on women's rights. We also find it, for example, in, again, just a couple of months ago, we had something called the Madrid Principles on Foreign Fighters agreed by the Security Council, an addendum to that, to those principles. And in fact, gender is found all over the document. You don't have to go looking for it. It's much more obvious than it used to be. So on a positive note, this would tend to signal some potentially positive progress on engaging gender in the security sphere. But let me offer a little bit of cold water to the party, as it were. So first, I would say that engagement with gender in the counterterrorism and security space remains a short form for a phrase that I want to call women and children, one word, right? So that instead of seeing women and children as two separate things that we need to address, we sort of do the one word slippage, women and children. So gender actually is equated as bringing women with children. And when you do that, as all of the feminists in the room will know, what you're actually slipping into is this sort of essentialism that assumes that when you talk about gender, first of all, that you're talking about women, and second of all, that when you talk about women, you're invariably assuming they have or want to have or are supposed to have children, and that that's where the primary focus of attention should lie. So this idea of slippage is really important. The second thing I want to say, to pour a little cold water on this engagement with gender, is that when we talk about gender, we don't talk about men. And it's really important to talk about men, because men are also, maleness is also a gendered category. And it is a particularly important category in the area of counterterrorism. So we yet have to address the masculinities, and in particular the hegemonic masculinities that sustain and produce violence, both globally and nationally, both in private and in public, in the context of violence and extremism. We also, I think, fail to do, when we talk about gender as a short form for talking about women, we fail to acknowledge men's vulnerability to violence and harm, including men's vulnerability to sexual violence. That remains occluded in many of the Security Councils of today, the conversations that we have today. And men as victims of terrorism and extremism are often invisible and unseen. One of the things that concerns me most as Special Rapporteur is that in many parts of the globe, men and young boys in many places are presumed to be combatants. That is to say, if you are aged between 16 and 40, you don't have, in practice, the privilege of being considered a civilian. You're presumed by virtue of your male gender as being a combatant, depriving men of the most essential aspect of civilian protection under international humanitarian law. So if we're really going to get serious about the endeavor of engaging gender in counterterrorism, we have to start to pay some serious attention to men, addressing both the masculinities that undergird radicalization and extremism. And let's be really clear, non-state actor groups, extremist groups, have figured out precisely the kinds of gender tropes that work to encourage young men to join extremist organizations. Anybody, I don't recommend spending a lot of time on ISIS websites, because unless you're a special rapporteur, you might find yourself in trouble. But it is important to note that much of the ways in which the grooming and preparation for engagement in violence is actually founded in, located in, gender tropes that are particularly appealing, particularly to young men who have no access to status or capacity or even economic viability in the societies that they live in. We also, I think, have to take seriously the rights breaching that occurs in sustained counterterrorism measures that are often addressed against men. And those are particularly important to pay attention to, because they also undergird the radicalization cycle that includes bringing and sustaining cycles of violence in many societies. And we have to also address the overwhelming masculinity of security institutions, internationally and nationally, that remain overwhelmingly male. So that's one. So men, if we're going to say, what's the first thing we have to talk about? We have to talk about men. The second thing, though, I do want to talk about women. And let me say a little bit about the ways in which women appear in counterterrorism discourse. And again, perhaps encourage us to think more critically about what looks like a progressive inclusion of women in counterterrorism discourses, but hides, I think, a much more problematic underbelly. And so what I would say, and again, many of you in the room will be familiar with this, is that when women become visible in counterterrorism or in terrorism discourses, they become primarily visible as victims of terrorism, playing the role in a way of the quintessential and archetypal victim of terrorism, meaning that the targeting of civilians, which is the essential legal piece or act that sort of defines terrorism as an unacceptable act, is focused on targeting someone who's a civilian. And often, as I said before, women are seen as the quintessential civilians. And there's no doubt at all, and I say this as a special rapporteur who's been committed to meeting victims of terrorism in every place I go, and understanding that victims of terrorism are the ones who bear the heaviest burdens of the costs of terrorist action. So I don't want my words to be taken as saying that I dispute the importance of recognizing victims and recognizing women as victims. But I also want to say that when you only recognize women as victims, you play into a set of essentialist tropes about women as a kind of an archetypal victim. And that's particularly true when much of the attention to women as victims is focused on sexual violence. It's illustrated, of course, when we see targeting of women by non-state actor groups. And perhaps the most recent and cogent example of this is the targeting of Yazidi women, including their sexual violation. Now, again, I want to say it's really important, both in international law and in international human rights law, that we pay attention to sexual violence against women. Historically, again, as many in the room will know, sexual violence in war was considered something that was just kind of sort of something that happened. It was not considered a grave breach of the Geneva Conventions. It took us quite a while. In fact, it's really 1977 with the additional protocols to the Geneva Convention that we really raised the status of a crime of sexual violence against women. And it's really not till we get to the ad hoc tribunals in the International Criminal Court that we establish firmly that rape and sexual violence is a war crime, is a serious breach of international law. So all of that has been really important. But I also want to say that it is a really challenging thing when the only part we see of women in international security discourses is women as victims and primarily as victims of sexual violence. We may be in danger of what a colleague of mine, Laura Schoberg, a very well-known political scientist, has called in danger of being swamped by the protection racket. And what do I mean by the protection racket? Mainly, I mean that when you focus only attention to the need, the protective needs of women, you lose a lot of things. What you lose is their autonomy. What you lose is the notion that women themselves can be actors, and women can be combatants, and they can be terrorists. And we start to hollow out the meaning of what kinds of harm are done to women and done by women. And what we do at the same time, oddly enough, and it's kind of a paradox, right, that when we focus on sexual violence, which is a really important, as I said, it's important to do, we inadvertently reinscribe notions of chastity, honor, dependency in this space. Because by focusing attention, by saying these are the worst crimes that can happen, we actually reinscribe very fundamentalist notions of what the importance and value that a woman has and brings to her society. And it's quite challenging that the only body, and I mean literally the physical body that we tend to see, is the sexually violated, penetrated female body. And we, in general, don't tend to talk about the other harms that women experience in conflict and in situations of extremity. We lose almost entirely attention to socioeconomic rights violations, including starvation, including lack of access to water and other basic rights. And we lose attention to the myriad of other harms that women experience in conflict. So the protection racket has a function, but it can also occlude as much as it opens. And I also want to say that one of the challenges when we focus simply on sexual violence as the preeminent thing that we should be talking about in counterterrorism discourses is that we also lose a set of precursor issues. We lose sight of the structural discrimination, the entrenched inequality, the lesser status, and the lack of access that women have to a range of rights and opportunities in their society, which makes them more vulnerable to sexual violence. So we're happy to talk about the sexual violence piece, but not about the conditions and the context that produces the vulnerability to sexual violence. And that precursor set of issues is almost entirely missing in the Women, Peace and Security agenda, and it is absolutely missing in the gendered engagement in the counterterrorism space. And so I want to suggest, as I've done in my policy work, that it is inherently important that we address these issues, but we address them in a holistic way. And this is where human rights marches in. And I want to, again, point out a paradox. It's a paradox of global governance, and it's also a paradox, I think, in the space of security engagement with gender, which is people talk about women, but they don't talk about human rights. It's as if human rights are separate from the discussion on gender. And it's extraordinary to say you can talk about women a lot in counterterrorism, but you don't talk about women's rights in counterterrorism. And what happened to Martin Scheinen in 2009 was that he focused on rights, not on harm. And states are perfectly happy to talk about harm because in general it's the harm caused by non-state actors to women, but not happy to talk about the precursor conditions that produce that harm, which are often enabled and sustained by states themselves. So the fault line, I want to suggest, that's currently being carved out in counterterrorism space for gender is the fault line that engages gender but not human rights. And it is only, I think, when we fully and substantively engage the lack of rights discussion and the lack of rights realization for women will we be able to address the conditions that produce their specific vulnerability to terrorism and violence, as well as their lack of capacity when counterterrorism strategies produce human rights violations. So rights talk and rights walk, it seems to me, are essential for women's advancement in the counterterrorism space. And rights talk continues to be extremely hard to do in the counterterrorism space. And let me talk a little bit about why rights talk is so hard in the counterterrorism space. The first is that thing I would say is that post 9/11, we created an architecture of counterterrorism that was meant to exclude human rights. There was a Security Council resolution that literally created an architecture. We had a Security Council and we created something new called the Counterterrorism Committee, which is really the central entity that regulates and directs counterterrorism enforcement at a global level. And there's a couple of really interesting things about that body. First of all, most people, average citizen, does not know about the Counterterrorism Committee. And when they look at the UN Security Council, many will say, well, that doesn't work very well. States don't agree. They don't work very well together. It's a chaotic situation. But I would suggest if we stood back and we looked at the Counterterrorism Committee, we'd see something quite different, which is that actually this is a space in which states work extremely well all the time. And so there's an extraordinary difference between the presumed dysfunctionality of the Security Council and actually the high degree of operability and efficiency. It's not perfect, but by global standards, it's pretty good in the CTC. And that body was created. Its first chairman was Sir Jeremy Greenstock, former British ambassador to the UN. And the ambassador made clear early on that human rights was not part of the work of the Counterterrorism Committee. And it took an extraordinarily long fight between 2001 and 2005, actually, and the creation of the office that I now hold, to start to talk about the relevance of human rights in the counterterrorism sphere. So rights talk is really hard because rights are not wired in to the way in which the global governance in counterterrorism works. And I'm going to use my own office as an example to illustrate the point. The Office of the UN Special Rapporteur was created between 2005 and 2006. It was
there were a number of states, including the United States at the time, who did not want this office created, partly because intellectually and policy-wise, they felt that human rights were not supposed to be in the counterterrorism space. This was not the space for human rights. And so the compromise, in part, was to create a UN Special Rapporteur's office, to create that space, and to add the Special Rapporteur as one of the 38 entities that exists in the global counterterrorism architecture. But let me be clear, that's not a solution to the absence of human rights in the global counterterrorism architecture. A Special Rapporteur has the competences that I've already outlined for you, and then you add in this other role of being an entity in the global architecture. Like myself, all of the previous office holders have full-time jobs, mostly as professors of law, doing their full-time work. So it's a part-time role, it's unresourced, and it has no meaningful enforcement capacity. So I want to underscore the point that not only do we have a structural problem, but even those things that were designed and created to offer some kind of counterbalance to bringing human rights into the counterterrorism space are woefully ineffective, but were created in a way that was designed for that to be the outcome. All right, I want to talk about two more things in the context of women and counterterrorism. And the first is the notion of women as, we've talked about them as victims. I now want to talk a little bit about women as frontliners in counterterrorism. And let me start by talking about women as combatants. And this issue, of course, is much in the news at the moment as we talk about the fall of the caliphate and the role that the international community is going to play in managing the foreign fighters that are left. And a sizable proportion of these foreign fighters include women and their dependent children. And as many of in the room will know, we have one Irish woman amongst them, which is, I have to just say, a really small problem compared to countries who have hundreds and hundreds of these fighters. And let's talk a little bit first about the perception of women in this space. It remains, I think, really important to underscore that women, this is not just an ISIL or a post-9/11 phenomena. Women have always been active in terrorist groups. This is not a new thing. And it's not new because we've historically chosen to either ignore or minimize the role that women have played in fighting organizations or as combatants. That's partly because there are these underlying assumptions that women simply can't be combatants. And again, that's a form of gender essentialism that I think is belied by the facts on the ground. And the other reason I think we haven't done so is because the range of acts that women carry out are multiple, right? Meaning that women play a variety of complex roles in armed groups, many of which are not seen as acts in themselves. So we tend to think of acts of violence as being direct acts of violence, but often exclude the range of other actions that enable, sustain, and support organizations to function and run. And historically, as well as now, women have played those roles. So the first piece, of course, is recognizing women as combatants and recognizing that women play active roles as combatants in both state and non-state groups. The second, of course, issue is now the contemporary challenge that many states are faced with, which is the question of returning fighters. And let me just address that a little bit. One is to acknowledge that the conditions in which many of these women and children, including the one Irish national who's to our knowledge, or the one Irish national woman was there, are appalling. These large detention camps are overcrowded. The conditions, I think my colleague, the Special Rapporteur on Torture, has articulated a concern that they meet the threshold for torture, inhuman, and degrading treatment by virtue of the conditions in which individuals are held. There are clear vulnerabilities to violence of those women and children in those camps. And it also remains clear that the non-state actor groups are exercising some control, what you might call coercive control, within those camps. So the extent to which women are free to say they do or don't belong to organization remains an open question. Now, in this context, it's interesting to me that we've had a slew of media attention, including in Ireland, to the kind of jihadi bride phenomena. It's sort of we might want to call it a purient interest, the ways in which we become obsessed with certain women
And then we kind of, in some ways, have to make them monsters in order to make sense of what they've done or who they are. I believe, and my office has been very clear, we have not communicated with the Irish government, but we've communicated publicly with a number of European governments in relation to their responsibilities in relation to these groups, individuals. The first is the position that all appropriate consular assistance should continue to be supplied to these individuals. And that, of course, in some cases is hard to do because they're being held by the Syrian Democratic Forces in a territory where states do not have consular presence. Nonetheless, we believe, and not just my office, but the Office of the High Commissioner has said very clearly that states in particular where there are risks of non-refoulement, where there is risks to the life and physical integrity of people, that states have to make a particular effort to support their nationals. And we see a number of states actually doing so. Surprisingly, perhaps Russia, Kazakhstan, Tunisia, Morocco, these are states who have made the decision to bring back all of their returnees, no questions asked. And I'd be happy to take more questions on that, recognizing that it's complex, but it's also recognizing the state responsibility, particularly to vulnerable child nationals, that they should be returned. The other piece of that frontlining or women's role as actors in the counterterrorism space is the question of reintegration. And I want to say that it feels to me at the moment like we're in a conversation that suggests that no state in the world knows how to do this, that it's a challenge of immense proportion for which we have no tools. And frankly, I don't believe that to be the case. A number of countries, including our own, we have to think north of the border and 1988 when we signed a Good Friday peace agreement in which we made provisions for the decommissioning and of weapons and the reintegration of individuals who had been charged with terrorist offences through legislation which we didn't call an amnesty but constitutes under international law a de facto amnesty for persons who'd been committed of terrorist crimes. And I want to make the obvious point that states like Ireland, but also states like Colombia, have lots of experience of doing integration, lots and lots of it. And there's an odd disjunction in our current global discussions about that reality that we've done DDR in many countries that are extremely complex with very challenging armed groups and armed actors, and it's not perfect. I don't want to suggest it is perfect, but what I do want to say is that we have a range of tools and mechanisms available to us that we seem to have forgotten in the current conversation. So in the context of frontliners, let me also move to one final substantive issue, which is the role of women in preventing and countering violent extremism. So we're about 20 years out from 9/11, and we've spent a great deal of time doing hardline military responses to terrorism. And globally, I would say, it hasn't been that effective. We're looking at the spread of global jihad. We've seen the rise of extreme violence in multiple countries, and our tools seem to be fairly limited. And in recognition of that, the Global Counterterrorism Strategy and a document produced by the Secretary General on preventing violent extremism has started to pay real and significant policy attention to the need to prevent before we do the next step, which is the hardline military responses. And interestingly enough, preventing and countering violent extremism has encountered or is using women as frontliners. Women are central to global strategies in preventing and countering. And of course, that's an interesting proposition that we're using and deploying women to do this work of prevention. And in some ways, it's obvious why we would do that. Women are situated in their communities. They know their families and their communities better than anyone else. They're engaged, because in many societies, women don't engage at the formal political level, but are more active in civil society because that's where space exists for women to be engaged. And frequently it's women who have access to the context and the spaces where violence is brewing and emerging. And so it makes sense that we would want to be talking to women about that. But I want to be sort of, again, a little cautious about what that step of using and engaging women in the countering and violent extremism space. First, let me note that we do not have a global definition of extremism. And one country's extremism is another person's legitimate, another country's legitimate protester. So we're using this language of countering and preventing violent extremism without an agreed definition among states as to what that phenomenon exactly is. And that's an extremely dangerous proposition because we have many states who are using the security space to do what might be called nefarious work, particularly in using counterterrorism and countering violent extremism as a way to deal with local dissenters, with some people who simply disagree with them. So that's the first challenge. And women, if they're the front line, run the risk of being caught up in state strategies of subversion, not of extremism, but simply of disagreement with the state. The second thing I want to say that's really sort of challenging about using women in this way is that there's a profound commodification of women in this space. So we're not letting women be part of security discourses. They don't sit at the tables where the security strategy is devised, but we're absolutely happy to have them in there preventing and stopping it. And when we do that, what we often underestimate is the risks that we place on women. And the danger that we expose women to extreme violence and extreme vulnerability in communities where they will be seen as agents of either foreign agendas or government agendas. And you run the risk by putting women as the front line of prevention of actually making those women more vulnerable and more potentially subject to greater violence. The other challenge, of course, is that much of these prevention and countering strategies don't have any human rights component. They're often about simply finding shortcuts around the human rights protections that people are entitled to. And so while I am critically aware of the importance of prevention, I have great fear about what it involves to put women at the front line of those prevention strategies and the danger that that poses for women and their communities. Let me close out by saying a little bit finally about representation, women in security. As I said at the very beginning, counterterrorism spaces tend to be extremely masculine spaces. As a female special rapporteur, it's sometimes it actually works to your advantage when you walk in at the head of a delegation because they're assuming that it's going to be a man who shows up. But equally, they'll assume there can be an assumption that you're somehow not up to the task by virtue of your gender. So it's often a good opportunity to undercut that. But the reality is that women's representation is limited and that increasing women's representation, which is an essential aspect of the Women, Peace and Security agenda across all security spaces, is really important. But it's also, I think, a danger to think that if we just add more women and stir, we're going to make it better. Meaning, and perhaps the quintessential example of this is the appointment of Gina Haspel as CIA director. Here we see, in some sense, women washing of coercive security practices by focusing on promotion as a way to not address the role of a particular woman in practices that have been identified and recognized by international courts as violative of international law. So we have to be careful of hoodwinking by tokenism. We have to be careful that simply putting more women in doesn't mean that the security matrix changes in any fundamental way. And this again speaks to the importance of a holistic approach to gender in the counterterrorism space. So let me close by saying that I think our greatest challenge in this space, we have many of them, but the greatest challenge I see as Special Rapporteur is the way in which there has been a consistent attempt to drive a wedge between gender and human rights. If we're going to talk about women in security spaces and the role of women in counterterrorism, we have to be talking about women's rights and human rights in the counterterrorism space. And I often refer, and still refer, to human rights as an endangered species in the counterterrorism space. That remains true. And if we talk about women and we don't talk about human rights, we are not solving the endangered species problem. Thank you very much.
Fionnuala, thank you. I'm really glad I came. That was well worth the trip down from Dublin. And I think that you've probably all got a lot to think about there, and hopefully we will have some discussion in a very shortly. But before we go into that, I'm just going to call on James Kingston to address a few remarks. James is the legal advisor in the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, and he's also the president of the International Law Association, and that's the Irish branch only, alas. But no doubt he will move upwards and onwards.
Ms. Justice O'Malley, Professor Ní-Éalón, ladies and gentlemen, let me first thank NUI Galway and the Irish Centre for Human Rights, particularly Professor Siobhan Mullally and Professor Ray Murphy, for inviting the Irish branch of the International Law Association to co-host this evening's distinguished lecture. The branch is a small association, a small group of international lawyers, with myself as president, in addition to my day job, that's already been mentioned in the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade. Ray Murphy is our treasurer, and Dr. Patricia Conlon is our secretary. But even though we're a small group, we're linked to a worldwide association. Let me say it's a particular pleasure to be back here in Galway this evening, because we are the Irish branch of the ILA and not the Dublin branch, as we occasionally have to mention to those of our friends who are less familiar with Ireland outside the Pale. I'm from Tipperary, by the way. Thanks, obviously, also to our chair, Ms. Justice O'Malley, for introducing our speaker, and I know she will be moderating the discussion shortly, and I don't want to delay that, so I'll just be very brief. I should say that our principal thanks, of course, go to our very distinguished lecturer this evening, Professor Fionnuala Ní-Éalón. And I wouldn't even attempt to summarize her lecture. I think it's sufficient to say that it was interesting and it was thought-provoking. And I'm sure we'll see that in the question and answer session we've just had. It's particularly impressive that we had such a performance after a very busy day for Fionnuala, involving interviews on RTE and a session at court this lunchtime, which I was very sorry to miss. Fionnuala has already described what she does, but I think it's worth acknowledging the particular importance of the role of UN Special Rapporteur for the Promotion and Protection of Human Rights and Fundamental Freedoms whilst countering terrorism. Her role is a particularly important one in the world in which we live today, ensuring that the protection of human rights and combating terrorism are seen as mutually reinforcing goals and not competing values or interests. Fionnuala, as well as dealing with what we might call the classic legal issue of balancing individual rights and the collective good, also brings a fresh and important perspective to her work by looking at the issues raised in her work through a gender lens. This can only enhance our understanding of the problems we face and the effectiveness of our role in combating the problems which we face. I've been lucky enough to meet Fionnuala on many occasions over the years in various places and in various contexts, reflecting the depth and breadth of her work. Now, I'm not here this evening wearing my Department of Foreign Affairs hat, but I think I'll be allowed to say how respected Fionnuala is by myself and my colleagues in the department, both here in Ireland and across the world. If I was asked to describe Fionnuala and her many capacities in a single sentence, I think I'd have to say that she combines her talents as a lawyer and an academic with her passion for human rights. She's a servant of the international community in its broadest sense. She's a highly distinguished international reputation, and deservedly so. But as well as being an international figure for the past couple of decades, as an adult, as a woman, she has always been throughout her life, consecutively as a child and as a woman, she's been a citizen of Ireland. She's a citizen of whom Ireland can be proud. And I hope that you'll all agree with me that this evening's lecture affords us a very welcome opportunity to acknowledge her here in her hometown and in the presence of her family. Thank you.